Hello and welcome to the Winnipeg High School Football Championships. I'm your host, Connor McBride. Today's game is between Dryden and Portage, and it's looking to be an exciting one. Today's game is brought to you live by LRSD-TV, Louis Riel School Division's very own internet-based television station. LRSD-TV is part of the broadcast media program at the Louis Riel School Division's Arts and Technology Center, and is completely run by students. Now I'm going to throw it up to Brian Cameron and Greg Teasman so that they can talk about the game. Take it away, guys.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the second of our games tonight between the Dryden High School Eagles and the Portage Collegiate Trojans, the Canadiens Bowl for the Winnipeg High School Football League. Welcome. My name is Brian Cameron, and I'm joined by Greg Teasman, and we're going to call your play-by-play and color this evening. We are part of the Louis Riel School Division and LRSD-TV, so we welcome you to be part of our broadcast and looking forward to a good football game between two very strong teams.
Both teams are Curry Division teams. They've had excellent years. Obviously, both teams have traveled a great distance to play here at Investors Group Field, so it's a wonderful time for the players to come in and play in the big stadium under the big lights. Just watching the fans from both teams starting to roll in, and their signs across over on the far side there celebrating Eagles football. We always appreciate a great football game, and I expect nothing but really good play of these guys, these both teams. Just to highlight a couple players here, Dryden's quarterback, Jarrett Hicks, was 18 for 38 for 438 yards and 8 touchdowns throughout the season, and threw at a 47.4% completion rate, which is pretty decent. What really stands out for me is his 754 yards rushing, so we'll be looking for him to take off and run quite a bit. For Portage Trojans, Tyler Morris is a rookie quarterback. He was 39 for 74. Pass completions, 641 yards passing, and he had a completion rate of 52.7%. So, right. Pretty good out of a rookie quarterback.
Well, yesterday, Greg and I got to be part of the press conference to kick off the Winnipeg High School football game bowl game. So, unfortunately, Dryden couldn't be part of that, but we were able to talk to the coach from the Portage, Mr. Irwin, or Coach Irwin from Portage. And so we're going to go to that interview and see what he has to say about today's games.
I think our semifinal was quite tough against St. Norbert. They really came to play, and then they gave us a tough contest. But the guys persevered. They never gave up, and played hard right through to the finish. And to a man, they understand, you know, that we got to play to the whistle, we lay it all on the line. This is all or go home, so we're excited.
I think our season went really good. You know, we had a good turnout for all throughout the season. A lot of guys, grade 12, 11, 10, all throughout. And I think we will definitely have a good competition for this next game.
So we'll go down to the field, and thanks Coach Irwin and Tyler Fedak for joining us yesterday so that we could have some insight into the game today. We're heading down to the field, and we watch the coin toss, and we'll get ready to get the game started. Good luck to both teams. Pretty much as far apart in the Winnipeg High School Football League as you can get, as we got a team from Portage and a team from Dryden coming in. Of course, much longer for Dryden to get here, but looking forward to seeing how they do. Looking at their record, they've had a very strong season this year, so they should be competitive today, Greg.
Yeah, I expect these teams to be fairly evenly matched, and I think it'll be a great game coming up.
True patriot love in all thy sons command. With glowing hearts we see thee rise, the true north strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land, glory. set free. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Thank you.
After all, Canada, teams are getting ready to head out for the first play.
So Dryden finished the regular season, seven wins, no losses. Portage were six wins and one loss. Again, both teams look to have some decent size, and both teams are pretty fired up on the sidelines to get started. Portage is wearing maroon, yellow, and white. And Dryden is gold, black, and white.
It looks like Dryden will be kicking off to Portage to start off the game.
Dryden will be moving from our left to right. There is a little bit of a breeze tonight coming out of the south, so Dryden will be kicking off into the breeze tonight.
In our previous game, we did not see the wind affect the game too much, so I don't anticipate that to be a problem for either team. And we are underway with the Canadiens Bowl, the Winnipeg High School football leg. Kicked off by Portage, picked up at about the 18-yard line and runs up the middle and finds a bit of room. Tackled on the play and will be brought down at about the 40-yard line.
Foster Gage, his receiver, returner, holder, punter, team captain for Portage. Probably seen a lot of Foster Gage. Gage Foster, my bad, sorry.
We'll get that straight. So, right off the bat, Portage quarterback Tyler Morris will look, hands off to their left side and taken on the play by number 35, but tackled immediately. Well, actually getting 6 or 7 yards out of that, pardon me, tackled immediately, but did find some room down the left side.
Braden Friesen with a nice run there, picked up about 6-7 yards. Number 11 made the tackle. Liam McFadden. Second and three.
So Morris lines up in the shotgun and will find some room. Number 88 finds some room down the left side. And Tyler Stack takes the ball, gets it down to the 48-yard line of Dryden for.
Tyler Fedak is a receiver, returner, team captain, 2016, under 18 team member.
First and 10 for Portage from the 49-yard line of Dryden. Morris continues in the shotgun with two men behind him. Hands off to number 35 and finds lots of room and moves into the middle. Lots of room brought down on the play by number 20 at the 22-yard line. Great run by number 35 from Portage.
Braden Friesen, number 35, grade 12 running back. Look for big plays out of him for most of the day today.
Good blocking by his front line to make that room too. So Portage will start from the 22-yard line of Dryden. Tyler Morris continues in the shotgun with two backs behind him. Hands off again right away to number 35, who will move to the left side, but caught pretty quickly this time by the Dryden line. Gain of about three, maybe four on the play.
Initially, I'm pretty impressed with the push up front from the Portage Trojans offensive line.
They're making some room for him.
Big number 67 left tackle there is got some decent size to him.
There's a big young man. Tyler Morris continues the shotgun, so second and six. Morris takes the ball back again, pitches it out to number 35, but caught and in fact for a loss of about 2 yards. Tackled on the play by number 55 from Joel Ottertail. from Dryden.
Great play. On that toss, he just fought real hard upfield and cut off the line for the running back to get outside, forcing him back inside.
So Portage will start off with will be going for a field goal attempt.
Timeout, Portage.
Portage has called a timeout.
Might be short a man here. Yeah, they didn't have enough guys on the field, so rather than risk getting that field goal blocked, they called timeout.
So number 9, Connor Green, will be attempting the field goal for Portage.
Holder's number 12, Gage Foster. Looks to be about a 31-yard field goal.
Oh, bad snap. Picked up on the play by number 9, Connor Green, who will try to run away and tackle for a big loss. Turnover on downs for Portage, and Dryden will take the ball over on the 35-yard line. Bad snap cost him that one.
Looks like
very good effort on Green's part to make something out of nothing, but turnover on downs.
Well, good opportunity here to see what Dryden's offense is going to be running and see what they have to offer.
Reasonable field position to start off with. Starting off under center from their own 35-yard line, first and 10. Fake to the left side of the road, keeps the ball himself, gets about 5 yards, maybe 6, and is forced out of bounds at the 40-yard line. Quarterback Jarrett Hicks. Tackled on the play by number 51, Eric McCutcheon. Good pursuit.
Jarrett Hicks had 754 yards rushing throughout the season, so I look to see him carry the ball quite a bit this evening.
You can start under center, second and 4. Continues the play and find lots of room, and there's nothing between him and the end zone. He's pursued on the play by number 12 and will tackle him at about the 12-yard line. Great run by number 5, Jarrett Hicks.
That's your basic option quarterback type of run. Obviously, he reads what the defensive end is going to do, and if he pitches down, he'll take it and run with it himself. Excellent effort by number 12 there to Gage Foster to track him down.
Great speed to catch up with him because Jarrett Hicks was gone. So first and 10 from the 12-yard line. Hicks will go back again, and he will look to go outside. Caught on the play right away, so he will get 3-4 yards. 3-4 yards based upon continued effort, but definitely wrapped up. Trying to get the tackler. Sorry, I'm missing this one, guys.
Cameron Travers with the tackle on that play. First time we've seen a team in the red zone today, so hopefully we'll see some points out of this game.
Second and 7 for Dryden. Handoff goes right up the middle for number 33 for Dryden.
Liam Wolstead.
So they're moving the ball well, but short of the first down.
Third down.
It is interesting as I look down the field, Greg, that the number of different socks on the Dryden team.
Yeah, those are interesting socks. We got pink, yellow, blue, black, stripes.
So we got 3rd and 1, so they are going to go for it. Takes the play and will run and push it up and should have the first down. Will be short of the end zone, but should have a first down on this one. Appears to be about the 1 yard line.
First down.
First down from the 1 yard line. So Eagles will taste it. First and goal. 6 minutes left in the first quarter. No score yet, but Eagles threatening from the from the 1 yard line. Harris will move up right under center. Hicks will move right under center.
Double tight.
Move to his right. Pushes.
Touchdown.
Called by the touchdown.
Again, all that has to happen is the ball just has to cross the plane. Looks like there is enough of the ball that crossed the goal line for the touchdown for the Eagles.
So Dryden will open the scoring 6-0 with the point after still to come. Good movement down the down the field after taking over the ball on downs to start off the game, Greg.
Both teams' offense have come out firing. Huge yards by Portage. Unfortunately, they missed a snap on a field goal. And now Dryden's had a huge play. And now
they're
going
faked
for
it
two.
In a wide open player, and they will easily get two.
Sleeper play.
Wide open to the left side was, it appears to be number two.
23.
Randy Russell from Dryden was wide open. Now the refs seem to be conferring about something, so I'm not sure what they're going to be talking about. There is a flag down on the play. I do see it now on the right side of the field. So we're waiting for the call. It appears like it's against Dryden, so they will be doing this again.
The question will be, will Portage cover him?
Portage is sending a cover man out this time. So they are setting up for the point after this time. Ball snapped, brought down. Almost blocked on the play by Portage, but through for the point after. Dryden takes a 7-0 lead with 5:39 left in the first quarter. Great start to the game, Greg.
Dryden strikes early, 5 minutes, 39 seconds left in the first quarter. Wow, both offenses moved the length of the field. Portage made that one little mistake with their snap on the field goal. Other than that, it's a pretty well-played little bit of the first quarter.
Seen some good football right off the bat from both teams.
Earlier this evening, we had the WHSFL Bowl, and we had St. John's against Colonies, and Colonies pulled out the victory to win the WHSFL Bowl.
The ball kicked off, got picked up on the play by number 55 from Portage, who will push it down the field. And finish, they get tackled at about the 41-42 yard line of Portage, so that's where they will start their second possession of the game with 5:33 left. Yeah, great first game tonight, Greg, between St. John's Collegiate and Kelowna East Collegiate, right down to the wire. Both teams, any team could have won the game, and just a nice way, or a great way to start these 2 days of football.
Yeah, it was a great game, well-played game.
So quarterback Jarrett Hicks, quarterback Tyler Morris continues in the shotgun for Portage. Rolls to his right, looks downfield, nothing's pursued well, throws the ball up, and it is caught at about the 45-yard line and tackled at about the 46-47.
Great job by the receiver there to come back. Anytime your quarterback is under pressure, you want to, as a receiver, you always taught to come back to the ball. He did a great job there.
And Tyler Morris, good poise on his part to make sure that he got the ball downfield, given that he was pursued so well on the play. Second and six from the 45-yard line. Continues in the shotgun, ball goes back, and this time it's handoff. Flag on the play, blown dead.
Early motion from Portage.
I do notice that there's no time on the clock on the 22nd clock.
Procedure, Portage, number 58. 5-yard penalty.
Forward, so
repeat second down.
Dryden will take the penalty. Second and 10 from the 40-yard line.
Oh, great pursuit.
Sacked on the play by number 55 from Dryden. Ottertail had basically went in almost untouched on the play.
Boy, is he ever quick. Come real hard off the edge there, and quarterback didn't have any time to set up and read or look for open receivers.
Making that third and 18, so Portage will be forced to punt on this play. from their own 33-yard line. Well, it's good punt. Very good punt from Portage. It pushes back the Dryden player to their third 25-yard line, and then the ball kicks back and gets picked up at the 12-yard line. Will be a no-yards call on this one, but got to tell you, great kick and great result from the Portage kicker on that play, Greg.
Yeah, you always want to turn the field on that. That was a great kick. Now you give Dryden a real long field to try to get into the red zone or to score a touchdown. So the flag on the play was no yards against Portage, so Dryden will be moving up.
No yards. Portage, number 56.
Five-yard
penalty.
Did hit the ground.
First down.
My bad. 5 yards.
So they will start, Dryden will start from its own 16-yard line. First and 10. Up 7-0 over Portage Collegiate. Quarterback kick starts under center and looks downfield and finds a wide open receiver, and there is nothing between him and the end zone. Will he get tackled in the play? Caught on the play again by number 12. Great speed from the Portage cover.
Gage Foster.
Great speed to catch that, catch the defender. The receiver again.
Hard to read the number on the Eagle player there.
First and 10 from the Portage La Prairie 15-yard line. Great speed, great throw on that play. Starting from under center, rolls to his left. Looking for some blocking, still has some blocking, finds some more room, and we'll get down to knocked out of bounds at about the 1 or 2 yard line. It appears that the ref is going to put him out about the 3, actually.
Another, when you have a running back who's that big of a threat to run and throw the way he's been starting this game, I think Portage got their hands full.
Dryden had some great blocking form in front of him also, and the patience of Hicks to wait for that so that he could move downfield was really helped to make that play run well. So first and goal from the 3 yard line, will hand off and go right up the middle, but tackled short, might get to the 1. Tackled on the play by number 99 and 84 from Portage La Prairie. So first and goal, second and goal from the 1 yard line for Dryden. Looking to make this game increase their lead from the 7-0 that stands right now with 1:50 left in the first quarter. Hicks gets under center. Hands off and goes right up the middle.
Wolfstead on the carry and the touchdown.
Dryden scores again. Second touchdown in the first quarter with 1:37 left already. 13-0 with the point after still to come.
Again, great push up front. Offensive lineman number 63 there. Left guard got a great push. Dylan Kruger for the touchdown.
Point after coming now. Almost blocked on the play again. Portage Collegiate Trojans are making a good effort to get to that ball in those kicks off, but just missing it, but giving Dryden a 14-0 start off to the game with 1:37 left in the first quarter.
Wow, what a start for Dryden, really. When you two huge long plays for almost touchdowns, getting into the red zone and then converting those into touchdowns. So well done, Dryden.
And if it wasn't for number 12, Gage Foster from Portage La Prairie, they would have had those touchdowns on those two plays for sure. Great speed shown by him to catch up and stop the receiver from going all the way. Kicked short, grabbed on the play by number 84, but tackled pretty quickly on the play by Dryden. So Portage will take over first and 10 from the 39-yard line. I know, Jordy.
Joining us in the booth is head coach of the Winnipeg Rifles, Jordy Wilson. Jordy, what are you looking for from these two teams?
What am I personally looking for? I'm looking for players.
Oh, sorry. I'm looking for players, actually, for the Winnipeg Rifles.
Do you have your eye on any of these players right now? Can you highlight any of the players that draw
interest? Yeah, I mean, honestly, probably the best offensive lineman I've seen this year is number 63, Dylan Kruger, as left tackle for Dryden. He is a super athletic kid. He's got good size to him. Apparently used to be a goalie, so he's got very good feet, athletic kid. He's pretty good.
Is their left tackle, you're saying?
He's their left tackle, yeah.
We have seen the ball go to the left side, so that makes sense. And then able to get some big yards.
Jordy, tell us about your season.
Bad snap on the play for Portage. It's picked up, and there will be sacked on the play.
Huge play for Portage there. Jordy, you want to tell us about your season this year with the Winnipeg Rifles?
Well, I mean, we had too many losses and not enough wins. That would be the starting point. But it was, you know what, I think in lots of cases, we came in there now. We had some issues, I guess, with the team. In order to make us a proper team, we had to maybe take a step backward this year to make a couple forward. We got a good nucleus of kids, and we should be a pretty solid team moving forward.
Do you have a lot of returning players?
We had lots. I mean, I only had, at the end, we had 8 fourth and fifth year players. I mean, Saskatoon has 25, Regina had 28, and Edmonton had 20, so yeah, we're very young. But yeah, it's just, yeah, we got to get the right mix of guys in there, and sometimes, you know, there had to be a bit of culture change in the team, so I think we're going in the right direction now. Our running back is Mike Rashad. Yeah, so Mike was with the Bombers actually this year in training camp. Except, unfortunately, he was the second leading rusher in the country, but he missed 4 games. So, it would have been nice to have him for the full season. Would have helped things.
For sure. So, playing for the Rifles involves you doing a lot of travel. What are some of the teams that you go out to play against?
In our conference, we have Saskatoon Hilltops, Regina Thunder, Calgary Coles, Edmonton Huskies, and the Edmonton Wildcats. We also played in the BC Junior League this year. We played against Chilliwack as well. So, we played in Vancouver as well.
So what do you believe? And you said that things are going to be looking better for next year. What kind of changes do you expect to see then?
We're going to change the way we play offense because I don't think we need to be a little more dynamic than we were. We were pretty static. We'll probably be a lot more misdirection, a lot more motion involved with our game, move the pocket a little bit more. Defensively, I think we'll just be about getting some maturity. We were very young up front and in our linebacker core.
So getting back to the game, Dryden takes the ball from their own 40-yard line and reverses the handoff, finds quite a bit of room right up the middle.
Obviously, the Dryden front offensive line is starting to take control of this game and certainly pushing the Trojans back a little bit.
And Porter's got some good athletes, too, like that number 12 who's playing, you know, he's on the field right now.
Foster Gage.
Yeah, he's like the 100-meter champ in the province. Like he's a fast, athletic kid.
Yeah, we've seen that a couple times already this game, and him in pursuit and being able to bring down the receiver for Dryden.
These are pretty, you know, based on what you would have seen in the regular season, these are pretty two evenly matched teams. I mean, right now Dryden's got the upper hand here, but these are certainly in the division they played, and they were the two best teams.
Yeah, so we just had a switch in quarter, so we're starting the second quarter. So Dryden reverses direction and we'll start again, first and 10 from their 52. Hicks is under center. Hands off again to push it to the right side. This time Portage has met him there. Might get 3 yards on the play.
Wolstead again.
Bit of an apology out to the Dryden fans, if I can offer that, Greg, that we are having a bit of a tough time seeing the numbers sometimes.
Yeah, it's a little hard to read the white against the gold.
They are hard to read.
Jordy, you recently, with the Rifles, you guys recently updated your uniforms. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, we changed our color schemes. We've gone from green and silver. So these would be military colors based on the name of our program. We've now gone to a charcoal color with the blue and gold. So we've kind of aligned, because we have a pretty big partnership of sorts with the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. So we're using the blue and gold, and we've mixed in the charcoal with it. So it looks pretty good.
Mm-hmm. And where do you guys practice out of and play out of?
Right now, this past season, we have a practice facility, North Winnipeg Nomads Field. And then we played our games here at IGF. That, we'll see how that proceeds moving forward, but that's where we've been at right now.
Great.
Getting back to live play, Hicks again under center. Goes out to his left side, finds some blocking room, tackled on the play at about the 43-yard line. Gain of about 8 yards. That will give Dryden another first down.
So last question, Jordy. If somebody wants to come out and try out for the Winnipeg Rifles, what's the first step that they have to take?
For the most part, what I've done is I've talked to all the coaches already, so we've kind of identified who the grade 12 kids are, and I've actually made personal contact with most of them. But the other thing is, if they are interested, there's people that we've missed or whatever. If you look on our website at riflesfootball.com, we'll be running a rookie camp March 18th and 19th in the U of W in the indoor soccer complex. We've certainly opened all people. We can evaluate them at that point.
Awesome.
Okay, on the last play, Dryden running back contained almost right away. Got about a yard, maybe a yard and a half on the play. So we're looking at second and nine, maybe 8.5.
A little break and play. Well, thanks, fellas. Good luck. Enjoy the rest of the game.
Thanks for joining us, Jordy.
Thanks, Jordy. Good luck next year.
Thank you. Oh, there we go. We made it safe. All right. Thanks, guys.
Jordy Wilson, coach of the Winnipeg Rifles, again, hoping for a better season than last year. I know had a bit of a rough one this year, but does have some prospects coming up and hopefully looking for some better things. So, anyways, Hicks throws the ball to the outside, finding room, lots of room on the outside. He's number 21 from Dryden. However, flags on the play. I have a feeling we're going to have a blocking call on this one.
Wow, what great speed on the number 21 there. Jacob.
Jacob Billis, sorry.
Great speed on that play.
I did.
I think it's coming back, though.
We saw a flag on the play. I think there was a block in the inside that actually allowed Billis to get that room. So, yes. So it is coming back. Showing some good speed down the side, though. Second and 19 from the 52-yard line of Portage La Prairie. Hicks comes under center. And he will look to pass downfield and throws it up. Overhead of his receiver. Might have been tipped away by number 16 from Portage La Prairie. Regardless, he seemed to have a better shot at the ball, Jaden Cook, than the receiver from Dryden did. So they'll be looking to punt. First punt of the game, if I recall. If I'm correct, but they've managed to control the ball well so far.
Late substitution coming on for Dryden here, number 21.
So
I think Dryden's calling timeout here.
Dryden's choosing to call a timeout, but regardless, third and 19 from the 52-yard line. They are punting to Portage, who has two players back.
Dryden's now used both their timeouts.
8:51 left in the second quarter.
So Dryden has an interesting formation here. They have basically a center and two guards, and then split out a little bit wider, two slot backs and two wideouts, and then four up backs.
Ball goes back. Good punt, fairly high punt, so ref blows the ball dead right away.
Ref blew it dead. Sometimes on a short kick like that or a short punt like that, what they'll do is they'll blow it dead in case of player injury or something along those lines, because when players are looking up at the ball, somebody can run underneath them and hurt them. So referee's discretion to call that dead.
So Portage will take over from just short of the 28-yard line. Looking to push the ball down the field. So quarterback Tyler Morris starting off in the shotgun with two backs behind him. pitches out to his right side, inside to number 88 from Portage, Tyler Fedak. And Tyler's the young man that we did interview yesterday for the at the press conference.
Number 70, Caden Taylor on the tackle on that one. He leads the team in sacks with 5.
No gain on the play, so 2nd and 10. Morris continues in the shotgun. So we're not exactly sure what's going on, but the referees have spoke to one of the players from Dryden. He sent him off the field. Oh, we got a better view now. He's bleeding, so he gets sent off the field for that reason. So a substitute will come in. That holds up the play for just a minute. In the meantime, I think you know, Portage needs to do something on this play to get something going with 8 minutes left in the second quarter, Greg. You know, down 14-0. I think they want to start getting into a bit of a flow so that they get themselves back into this game.
Yeah, they want to establish something, give them an offensive identity here.
So Morse starts off in the shotgun, rolls to his left, but got interrupted, but kept himself up in the field, but unfortunately was able to only get back to about the line of scrimmage, so it looks like Portage will be punting again.
Great balance by Tyler Morris on that play. Everybody in the stadium there thought he was going to go down on that first contact, but was able to keep his feet going and keep going. Unfortunately, not enough for a first down, and Portage will be punting again.
Looking across the field, Greg, the Dryden Eagles look to have a fairly good cheering section contingent who decided to travel with them and be a part of this game. Good to see that.
That's awesome.
Getting ready for the punt, and it goes back. And again, Portage punter is really doing a good job today. So it's picked up at the 45-yard line by Dryden, who will swing it to his right. Grabbed on the play and brought down to about the 50-yard line of Portage and Prairie. So a good about 10-15-yard return on that one.
Thomas Moline on that punt return. He's only played 2 years of football. Led the division in interceptions this last 2 years. Well, the question here, Brian, is can Portage stop these guys? They don't want to go down 21-0. Obviously, defense's number one goal is to get the ball back for their offense. So hopefully, for Portage case, they'll be able to get a turnover here.
Right. So Hicks starts under center, hangs onto the ball, waits for some blocking to form up front, and does find a bit of room, but he's eventually tackled in the middle and brought down. Actually ends up getting about a 7-yard gain.
A little bit of a broken play there. I'm not sure if that's the design of that play, but sometimes you just have to make something out of nothing. And I think that the coach didn't draw it up like that, but you got positive yards, so that's always a good thing.
So 2nd and 3 from the 43-yard line of Portage. And Hicks continues to work from directly under center. Moves, reverses the play, and gets a. His running back gets about 1 or 2 yards close to a first down. Number 17 of Portage on the tackle, Eric Nash. Very close to a first down. Looking up from here, that they are a bit short. So it is a third down.
Couple inches. The way the Eagles' offensive line has been playing today, I suspect that they'll be able to get the first down here.
And they should be going for it.
Wonder if they're going to run behind number 63,
their big left tackle,
Dylan Kruger.
So Hicks will keep with the ball and ends up getting about 4 or 5 yards out of it. Will swing to his right. First down for Dryden, who continued to move the ball. Last 2 or 3 plays, not big yards in each play, but just enough that they can keep the ball, Greg. Clearly that offensive line is making some things work for them.
Well, you know, Brian, one of the things as an offense coordinator is you want to wear down that defense. And,
yes.
And with the way Dryden's been playing, I suspect Portage is going to have a little bit of a hard time come second half if they don't control the ball a bit more.
So 1st and 10 from the 36. The ball is kept on the run, handed off to Kinnam. Ended up moving to the middle, gets about 3-4 yards. Second and six from the 32-yard line.
One thing I like about Dryden is they're in and out of the huddle real quick.
Yeah, they don't waste the time. So Hicks under center moves back, and he's looking to throw. Throws down the field and finds his receiver, but dropped on the play.
Pass was a little bit behind the receiver on that one.
Dropped on the play by number 30, Mason Desotel. So third and six, but it appears like Dryden's going to continue to try to go for it. Hicks lines up under the ball again. Pitches back to his running back, who is met on the play, and it will be turned over on downs. A gain of maybe 2 or 3 yards on the play. Probably the play that Portage needed, Greg.
You know, you're exactly right, Brian. I mean, if I'm Portage, if I'm the coaching staff with 4 minutes left in the half here, you need a big stop from your defense. Now, you got to look for Portage to come out and start moving the ball and taking a little bit of control here. From the Portage coaching staff point of view, you know, put up some points on the board before halftime.
So they will start first and 10 from their own 32-yard line with just under 4 minutes left in the second quarter. Handed off right away, and some room found up the middle, taken by, appears to be, big number 92. Colin McGregor, maybe 82, pardon me.
In on the tackle was Caden Taylor, number 70, defensive end, grade 11. One thing I really like about the Dryden defense is they swung the ball.
I'm looking at Tyler Morris. He swung out as a receiver here. So someone else has got number 12.
Gage Foster,
the speedster that we saw earlier in the game, who was able to make those tackles for Portage and prevent touchdowns, is moved into the quarterback position.
But what they do sometimes, Brian, is they'll move a quarterback out wide and bring a different player and call that wildcat offense.
So third and two, Portage will go for it. Morris goes back into the quarterback position. Ball was a high snap, but Will should get enough for the first down, about 3 yards.
Hit hard on the play.
Run on the play by number 35, Brandon Friesen.
57, Gunnar Anderson was also in on that. Looks like they got enough for a first down, though.
So first and 10 from the 43-yard line for Portage. Good to see that they're, for their case, to move the ball and be able to do something against this very strong Dryden defense. So Morris continues in the shotgun, looks to his left, but nothing there. Throws inside, nothing. Incomplete pass.
Dryden was trying to set up the screen there, and well read by, Portage is trying to set up the screen there, well read by Dryden. Obviously, the smart play on that was for the quarterback just to throw it away. And
although I would tell you that he did throw it into his offensive lineman, so if he had caught it, it would have been an ineligible receiver.
I played O-line. Most of those guys can't catch. So, safe play.
Second and 10. Number 12, Gage Foster, moves into the quarterback position. Moves to his right, looking for some blocking, cuts in towards the center of the field. It's covered quite well, might end up stopped with about 5-6 yards.
Again, real strong effort by Dryden to hustle and swarm to that football. There is a flag down on the far side.
So we're waiting for the call from the referee, but good effort to even get those 5 yards.
That'll bring up third and five for the Trojans.
I guess there was no flag. Maybe been dropped in air.
Well, Portage is going to go for it with third and five with 2 minutes left in the second quarter. Morris has stepped back into the quarterback position and looks downfield and has an open receiver. Oh, it's picked off. Stepped in front of the ball just as it was going to get to his receiver.
36.
Picked off by number 36.
Thomas Moline.
Thomas Moline from Dryden picks up the ball just before it was going to get to the receiver for Portage of Perry for a reasonable gain and a first down.
Well, Moline was sitting back there playing free safety. Play came right in front of him. He stepped up, made a great catch, and turnover. He led the league in, led the division in interception, so I'm not surprised that he was able to pick that off.
Good read by him. So Hicks will get under the quarterback for Dryden and move the ball from about his only his 47, 46 yard line. Gets maybe 2 or 3 yards from his running back.
Very physical play on that one. Both sides of the line are pushing real hard and working really hard to flow to that ball.
You haven't seen one of those big plays for a while, Greg. So that'll make it 2nd and 8.
A little bit of smash mouth football going on right now.
Hicks is under center. Hands off again right away, but there is some room this time. And gets Whoa. First down. Hits his, stays on his feet. Great hit on his place and great job staying on his feet by number 33 from Dryden.
Took a hit and kept his feet going, and balance was great. Huge, nice little gain on that play with about a minute left in the half.
So 1st and 10 from the 45-yard line. The scoreboard showing 40-yard line, but it is the 45. So Hicks drops back to pass and throws it down the field. Knocked away on the play just at the last second by number 45 of Portage, from the Portage Trojans.
Beery. Nice job by the DB to knock that ball out of bounds. Again, Dryden in and out of the huddle real quick.
So 2nd and 10. Handball in the reverse. Finds a bit of room to one side. It will find move up field to continue down the right side. Carter Armstrong, number 14 from Dryden. Great 14, 15-yard play.
Yeah, a little bit of a counter or reverse. Obviously, you get the defense flowing one way and then come back the other way and run against the flow. So, nice little play. Good play call by the Dryden coaches on that one.
Coming up to 30 seconds left in the half. 1st and 10 from the 31-yard line for Dryden. Hicks steps back to pass and looks down to his left side, but throws the ball way out of the way for his receiver, number 21, Jacob Billis.
Good cover on the play by Connor Green, grade 11 DB for Portage.
So 2nd and 10 from the 31 with 23 seconds left in the quarter. Dryden looking to score to add to their lead, 14-0. Hicks continues to work right under center, hands the ball off, and the quarterback, running back will find it, get close to that first down marker.
Gotta love Wolstead. I mean, he's not the biggest running back in the world, but he's got a nice low center of gravity, keeps his feet pumping. First initial contact, he's always getting 4 or 5 extra yards after that first initial contact.
Seems to have some pretty good lateral movement to give him some of that extra yardage too. So 3rd and less than 1, and they will go for it. Fumble on the play. Now it appears that Dryden has got it back, but that will be a turnover on downs with no time left on the clock. Just waiting for what the refs say. Yes, they're indicating that it is Portage ball, but there is no time left on the clock, guys.
End
so that's the end of the first half. 14-0 for Dryden. Great first half so far. Started off, I almost thought it was going to be a bit of a shootout, Greg, but settled down in some good smash mouth football, as you said, with teams really fighting hard for the yards that they did get.
Yeah, you can see that Dryden has been very explosive in the first half. They've had two or three really nice plays.
Okay, we're going down to the field to have an interview with the Dryden coach.
I'm here with the head coach of the Dryden Eagles, Jeff Zilkins. Jeff, your team's pretty in the lead right now, but what are you going to tell your team to keep that up?
We know we have to play physical. They're very strong, and they're not going to go anywhere. So we've finished games off before. We're hoping just to keep pushing on offense.
Okay, well, I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Have a good one.
You too.
All right, stay tuned for the end of the year intermission, and I'll interview the next coach.
Take a bit of a break. We'll be back just before the start of the second half in just over 9 minutes. So thank you for joining us for the Canadiens Bowl, the second of our games today. Dryden leads 14-0 after the first half, and we're looking forward to a good second half of football. Thanks.
Your creative side shine in the aesthetics program at ATC. This 11-credit, one-year-long course allows students to gain the skills necessary to work in the aesthetics field. This course teaches students about manicure, pedicure, nail art and treatments, skincare, makeup artistry, hair removal, and relaxation massage.
We provide a theoretical skill, so you are able to read a technical document, learn about facial products or foot care products or hand care products, and we also most importantly teach the practical skill, which is how to do the services.
A good teacher is the major key to anyone's success. ATC has well experienced and hardworking teachers from the field of aesthetics. Students get to work with them and learn from their experience.
It doesn't matter if you have any knowledge about this course or not, because the teachers help you a lot and they help you learn all the basics.
Students are prepared for the industry in the salon handled by the teachers with the help of the students. This gives students the experience of working in a real salon. All the students here get to work on real clients under direct supervision of their teachers. All the theory that is taught in the classroom is transferred and is applied to clients in the salon.
I think it was really good that we got to deal with customers here because it really prepared me for going into the industry.
Some of the students from ATC's aesthetics program are already working in the industry as well. Students have to work in the ATC salon in order to take the government-issued exam. Then they have to work in the industry after graduation to be able to take the other part of their exam. If the student passes both the exams, they will get their government-issued license.
Well, all of the training in school has been a huge part because we get to work on clients, and all of that really helps kind of give us a feel of what the workforce is going to be because it runs like a full salon. And then obviously we've had all of our training on how to do all of the services in class as well, so without that we wouldn't be able to work in the workforce.
Aesthetics is broken into two parts. In the first semester, students learn about manicure, pedicure, artificial nails, and body. They also learn the basics, like how to apply nail polish and a basic massage. Students are taught about anatomy, which is described as knowledge about muscles and bones in the human body. Anatomy is a part of the massage technique.
In the aesthetics program, the students will be learning everything from manicures, pedicures, to artificial nails. They'll be doing nail art. We cover sciences, we cover a little bit of biology, skincare, makeup artistry, body massage.
Students that have graduated from the aesthetics program are getting jobs and being successful in the industry as well. The quality of work that is taught here with the hands-on experience helps students to find jobs easily in the industry. Students learn all the aspects of aesthetics, which gives them the opportunity to specialize in one they like the most. Examples are nail art, skincare, or makeup.
All the advice and tips and everything they taught me here, I use it to this day. They really, really helped me in preparing me.
If you're interested in aesthetics programs and looking for some good experience, call ATC today and get enrolled in aesthetics program. To get more information, call 204-237-8951 or visit our website.
It's modern. It's professional. is creative. The hairstyling program at the Art and Technology Center will get you into this growing industry. This course will provide students with theory, practice on mannequins, and on-the-job training on real clients in the modern, well-equipped salon facility. Students will be prepared for employment in the hairstyling industry after they graduate.
It's 1,400 hours of in-school training that the students have to complete. And in part one, they work a lot on mannequins. They start to develop their skills and gain their knowledge that's needed to move into part two. In part two, they're working on clients 3 days a week. When they reach part three, we're really preparing them for the industry and for their apprenticeship exam. They basically are running the salon at that time with, of course, the assistance of their teachers.
Students will spend time in both the classroom and the school's professional salon.
In my opinion, the facility is the best in Canada. It is modern, it's state of the art, it has all the equipment, all the students have the equipment they need at the station. It's a real salon feeling.
Students will have the opportunity to work with clients over the course of their program. Students can also complete a one-week offset work practicum. At the ADC Salon, students offer hairstyling and aesthetic services to clients. All services are performed by students in training under the supervision of certified and licensed hairstyling instructors.
We get a lot of real-life experience working in the salon with clients 3 mornings a week. We get exposed to a lot of everyday situations that you would come across in a real salon.
The atmosphere, facility, and instructors are why students love taking this course.
It's because I have a creative mind and I wanted to test my skills.
I love it, yeah, it's very fun. I'm really enjoying it.
I love the hairstyling program.
I had always loved doing hair. I still. So in grade 12, I decided to come here.
The instructors in this program are professionally trained with years of industry experience. Their commitment to the program and its students' learning fun.
They're very outgoing. They're very patient as well. They're very fun to be around. I like that they really like to make sure that we understand what we're doing, and they give us a lot of their own types of experiences that they've had in salons, which is very beneficial to our learning. I love them. They're very fun.
Students can earn a certificate if they successfully complete a course requirements. Students must maintain a minimum accumulative average of 70% and complete all required hours. This course is accredited by Apprenticeship Manitoba. During a 2-year apprenticeship, a theory exam will be administered by Apprenticeship Manitoba.
I feel that they prep you 100%, everything that you need to know for the government exam, and me going into my government exam. Yeah, I had a little bit of nerves, but that's just normal, but I felt well prepared, and I wouldn't pick any other program.
For more information, visit www.lrsd.net or call 204-237-8951.
He's ready. Hold on.
Trojans, Brent Irwin. Brent, I was just wondering what you told your team to fire them up for the next half.
I told our team we need 12 guys playing on the field. We've got too many guys standing around waiting for something to happen or watching somebody else trying to make something happen. That doesn't work. You need 12, especially when in a championship game like this. So I expect our guys, they know what they need to do. Now we got to make it happen.
Of course. Well, I wish you the best of luck for the next half.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. All right, now we'll throw it up to Brian Cameron and Greg Kiesman. Take it away, guys.
Well, welcome back, folks, to the second half of the Canada In Bowl tonight at the Investors Group Field. Second of our high school football games for the Winnipeg High School Football Bowls. Game match between the Dryden Eagles and Portage Trojans. Tough game so far for the Portage Trojans, who have not been able to score. Defense has played fairly well for the most part, but Dryden is ahead 14-0, Greg.
Yeah, Brian, two outstanding, huge plays for Dryden one long pass and one long run by the quarterback. Almost scored. Great effort by Portage to come down or make the play to prevent a touchdown. But both times that Dryden's been into the red zone, they've been able to convert and given a score of 14-0.
So start off the second half, Portage will be kicking off to Dryden, giving them the ball right back. They were able to get the stop, Dryden, who were marching right before the half and ended up giving up the ball on downs.
Great kick all the way down to the 10-yard line.
Picked up on the 10-yard line by Dryden, and he will move to his left side. Tackled on the play. Long yard there, a long run to get two or three yards, Greg.
Excellent tackle on the play by number 88 there from Portage. Actually don't have his number, but yeah, the Dryden kick returner probably ran about 50 yards to gain four. Tyler Fedek from Portage made that tackle.
So we welcome Rick up from Rick. Winnipeg High School Football League up for to join us for part of the second half. And
Rick, this time I'll stick around.
Rick Hankwich, commissioner of the Winnipeg High School Football League, is now joining us in the booth.
Welcome, Rick. Well into our second game tonight, and things have gone really well today, Rick. So what do you think about the game so far?
It's about what we expected, 14-0. It's about what we expected, 14-0. Keeping Portage off the board is an accomplishment. They are, they've got number 12, Gage Foster. Gage is the Manitoba 200-meter champ. They got number 88, Tyler Fedak. Tyler might be one of the fastest guys in the league on the football field, just pure explosive speed. So Dryden's done a heck of a job, and Portage right now defensively is, Dryden had two big plays. So this has been, this has kind of been, the first five rounds of a 15-round fight.
Yeah, that's right. Greg said at the start of this half that really it's been two big plays that have put Dryden where they are in position in terms of scoring. Otherwise, Portage has actually played quite well with them.
And they have. It's been really good.
Talk to us about what you thought about the first game today, Rick.
Wow. St. John's Kildonan Nice was it was just an amazing game. It was an emotionally charged game. St. John's came down, opening drive, and came away with that field goal, and then all of a sudden you've got Kildonan Nice coming back and going up 14-3 in St. John's, and they just kept going at it. They just went toe-to-toe, and I got to tell you, even the ending, I mean, wow. The illegal receiver downfield versus what may have been a pass interference call, where it was just great. I mean, and I felt for the St. John's kids. Quite honestly, on a sentimental side, Brian Marks is an old friend. I really, really did want to see him win a championship. But you know what? This is Kildonan Nice's first championship, and they deserved it. They played well.
They did play well. Could have been either team at the end of it. Just a great first game to start with. I know Greg and I were so very happy to have had an opportunity to be part of it.
Final score in that game was 35 for Kildonan East, 32 for St. John's. And we were just saying with about a minute left, St. John's had the ball. They had an opportunity to march down the field and try at least a field goal. But Kildonan East did a really good job in stopping them.
Oh, yeah. No, you know what? Kildonan East, Danny Harris, who turned out to be the player of the game, he really took that team on his shoulders, I thought, and made some big, big plays for them. So
playing both sides of the ball most of the game, too, from what we could see.
Absolutely, yeah. He's their starting quarterback, and he's their starting field corner. So he's an amazing athlete, you know. And again, another kid, I think Danny's grade 12, and I'd love to see him go up to the next level. Size will be interesting for him, but man, his heart's as big as it comes.
Yeah, definitely had the heart to make up for the size. Definitely a very quick young man. That's one of the things we got out of it. Just going down to the field here for a second, Portage is moving the ball. They're actually sitting on the Dryden 30-yard line, first and 10. Looking to see if they can get themselves on the board for the first time this game.
Well, this is an important drive for Portage. They really do need to come away with some points here. It's an emotional uplift for them to come away with something here.
Tyler Morris takes the ball from the shotgun, feeds the ball off to his running back, number 35, Brandon Friesen, who does get up for about 4 or 5 yards on the play.
Once again, that Dryden defense, they just flow with the ball. They're wild dogs out there just chasing it down.
Second and about six.
The Dryden front four don't come up field hard. They just kind of hold that line. They play a little more of a passive style. And you're right, they just attack the ball.
Yeah.
It's really interesting to watch them.
Second and six. Portage looking to continue this series or at least finish something with something stronger. Pitch out to number 88. Who finds a bit of room upside and will push and push up and get close. If he doesn't get the first down, he'll be very close to it.
That's Tyler Fedek.
Fedek,
who we did interview yesterday. Nice young man that we chatted with yesterday as part of our...
And I think the last 4 or 5 yards of that play, Tyler got on his own.
He does end up with a first down on the play.
You know, that's one thing I've noticed out of both games is a lot of these players, probably why they're in these bowl games, players, after initial first contact, they keep their legs driving. They get another additional 3-4 yards.
Not much quit. So first and 10 from the 20-yard line. Portage hands on off the ball again. Lots of room. Fedek has really moved the ball well, quick, but met on about the 11-yard line of Dryden. So we'll be second down, but gets about 8 yards out of the play.
If you notice when Tyler squared his pads up there, just the explosion of his speed. He has an instant acceleration. And Greg, you're right. One player doesn't bring him down. You saw him spin off a couple of tackles there.
So he ended up being 9 yards of the play, second and one. Morris in the shotgun with two backs behind him. Takes the ball and hands it off again. But this time met in the backfield. For a loss of 2 or 3 on the play. Be interesting to see what Portage decides to do in this case. Will they go for it or will they take a field goal attempt?
If they go for it, it's going to be both 3rd and 4. If they do kick a field goal here, which I don't think they'll do, the ball's in the middle of the field. It's not a bad spot to try a field goal.
Well, they're not. They're going for it.
Yeah.
So 3rd and 3 to continue the series.
Now, let's keep in mind that Tyler Morris is a grade 10 quarterback here, too. Lots of pressure.
Hands the ball off to his running back, number 35, Brandon Friesen, who finds some room and should, I think, have the first down. It's going to be close if it isn't.
Nice run by Friesen.
Trying to look at the marker where the ref's foot is. I think he got it, Greg.
Looks like he does. They might have to bring out the chain gang and measure this, but...
No, they're like moving it. They're moving it. So, first and goal from the 9-yard line.
I believe this is Portage's first time down in the red zone, so see if they can convert here.
Got some good momentum going here. So, first and goal. Morris looks back and throws to the receiver, tipped up in the air.
Intended for Fedek.
I think Dryden's number 99 kind of got away with one there. If you take a look there, FedEx trying to release to the flats, and 99 just held them down. So they got away with one in there.
Fedek also lucky that when he tipped that one up in the air that it wasn't picked off. So second and goal. Pitches out to Fedek, who cuts back to the inside, but is met at about the 5-yard line. Will be well short of the goal line.
Well, Brian, what do you do here?
Well, I think I'm getting the impression that Portage believes they can do it. On the previous series when they went and they had third and four, they went for it, so I'm thinking they're going to go for it. Yep, well, we don't see a field goal unit coming out, so they're going to go for it. Just keeping in mind that they haven't scored at all yet. Morris gets the ball, a high snap, but he manages to hang on to it. Fedek cuts to the inside, but will be short of the goal line.
Wow, he got down to the one there.
Turnover on downs, Dryden will take over the ball at the 1 yard line. Good series by Portage. Disappointing for them that they weren't able to come up with some points this one, but definitely showed that they were able to move the ball.
Good good technique by Dryden there on the tackle. Again, tackling is all about heart and desire. You got to make sure that you use the correct technique, but you got to have the heart and desire to bring that player down. And that was a good effort by Dryden.
So Dryden will take over from their own 1 yard line. First and 10, they do not waste time over the ball. So Rick is going to be off. Thanks for joining us, Rick. Good to see you. Hopefully we'll see you again tomorrow.
Oh, we'll be around again tomorrow.
So first play from the 1 yard line.
Wolstead got them out from underneath the shadows of their own goal posts. So now their ball's out on the 10 yard line.
About a 9 yard run. First and second and one. Hicks continues to work under center with one back. Pitches out to his back. Oh no, fakes it. Runs it himself and gets 10, 12 yards at least. Maybe even closer to 13, 14 yards. Good run by Hicks.
Once again, Jared Hicks. He's throwing a lot of maturity for a grade 11 quarterback out there, making all the right decisions.
Got some good speed too, and having that blocking for me, as we talked about his left tackle before, clearly benefiting from that young man's size.
Yep.
So first and 10 from the 24 yard line. Hands the ball off immediately this time and gets about 3-4 yards for Wolstad.
McCutcheon in on the tackle.
Ends up getting about 5 yards on the play, so second and 5. Coming up to 3 minutes left in the first quarter. Dryden up 14 to nothing. Oh, nice catch on the play, but passed by Jared Hicks.
Number 21.
Catch on the play by number 21, Jacob Billis. Definitely had to pick that one off his shoes.
Good concentration on the play. Nice little gain. Again, Dryden had the ball at the 1 yard line. Now they're all the way out to their own 46 yard line.
So first and 10 from their 46 yard line. Moving the ball quite well. Hicks moves to his left and finds some room and will be pushed out of bounds with a gain of about 4 or 5 yards. Definitely looking and setting up behind that blocking that he's been getting. I'm getting a good view of that left tackle that he's benefiting from, Greg, and that is a big young man.
Can't teach size, Brian.
Can't teach size. So second and 5, second and 6 to go. Hicks passes, hands the ball off, and will be tacked immediately. Tackled on the play by number 6, I see in there, number 45.
45 was first contact. Bryce Berry. Grade 11 player for Portage. Excellent play, just shooting that gap and making that play in the backfield. Forcing Portage to punt.
My apologies there. I think I said no. It is number 6. Linebacker Dawson or Roulette. So they punt the ball away. Picked it about the 30 yard line. Number 12.
Gage Foster.
Gage Foster. And I'll tell you, I'm looking down at him.
Kale Oldberg on the tackle.
Well, it wasn't him, it was another player, but came up with a bit of a limp from the Portage team.
Portage was able to take it all the way down the 1 yard line last drive. Let's see what they have for us this drive.
They will start from their own 36 yard line, first and 10, with just under a minute 40 left in the third quarter. Tyler Morris will continue in the shotgun with two backs lined up behind him who will split off. Pass on the play, but covered easily. Gage Foster's covered quite well on the play and might even have a bit of a loss there. Yes, in fact, not a bit of a loss, 3 or 4 yards.
Avery Spence was out there to help out with the tackle, linebacker for Dryden.
So a long second down ahead of them. Second and 14.
Sorry, Joel Ottertail.
Just takes the ball, hands it all off to the inside. And tackle the play, gain of maybe 3 or 4 yards on the play. Yeah.
In on the tackle was number 99, Bailey Murrah.
Seems like Tyler Morris is having to deal with a few high snaps this game, Greg, and you know that I know that sets him off balance when he's trying to look downfield or make something happen.
Yeah, it throws the timing of the playoff a little bit.
Definitely had to deal with that last play.
Nice punt.
Nice punt again, this time by number 12. 36 from Dryden has the play and will break away from his tackle and eventually get pushed out at about the 50-yard line.
Nice job by 36 to catch our ball in the air. Thomas Moline. Well, again, Dryden's going to have the ball in decent
six
field position.
Six seconds left in the third quarter now.
And, you know, if they hang on and control the ball and don't make any mistakes, they're looking pretty good for Canadian's bowl win.
So starting from their own 50-yard line, must have been a penalty on that play. I missed that, Greg.
Well, everybody's offside on this one.
Oh, definitely.
Jared Hicks is so dropped for a loss in the play.
The question I'm going to have is, who was offside first, I guess?
There are flags in the play.
I think I saw offside coming from both sides of the ball.
Well, most defense coordinators always tell their players to point at the old lineman.
Offside, Portage, number six.
They
got 5 yard
penalty.
Portage,
so
repeat
so first
down.
And five.
You know, the coaches, those offside penalties are one of the ones that drive them craziest because they nickel and dime teams to death. So first and five from the 55-yard line midfield. And Hicks
first
will hand
back.
It off, and yeah. He might get a yard or two out of that one.
Wolstead again.
So because that was on penalty, that was the last place, last play of the quarter. So we're going to move, switch sides of the field to finish this game.
Won't be that far of a walk to switch sides of the field.
They're playing right around center.
Yeah. 55. Well, we have a break in the action here. Tomorrow, Thursday, November 10th, we have the CTV Bowl at 5 p.m., which has the Kelvin Clippers versus the Steinbach Sabres. And we're going to conclude with the Anovitz Bowl at 7:30, St. Paul's Crusaders versus Vincent Massey Trojans. Of course, it's a rematch of last year's championship game, and Vincent Massey are the defending Winnipeg High School Football League champions.
So here we go to start off the fourth quarter, our finishing quarter of this game. Dryden up 14 to nothing. Some kind of timing problem there. Quarterback Jared Hicks ends up throwing it into the dirt just in front of his receiver. So that will make this third and three. So Dryden will be punting the ball, and boy, Dryden sure does not waste any time getting rid of the ball. Good punt this time. Picked up on the play by number 88, who will find some room up to the middle, but collapsed on quickly and will end up getting the ball up to about the 38-yard line, where Portage will take over down 14-0 with 11:23 in the fourth quarter. And I'm thinking that they really need to get something going here. They have been able to move the ball, but they really have not been able to finish it. So they will start first and 10 from their own 37-yard line. Quarterback Tyler Morris continues to work out of the shotgun. Pardon me, that was Gage Foster, quarterback, trying to make something happen and might have got back at the line of scrimmage. That's a bit of a loss, about 2 yards lost there. So it'll be second and 12. Back into the game comes Tyler Morris. So second and 11, at least. Morris pitches the ball out to number 35, his running back Brandon Friesen, who will be met hard at the 45-yard line by number 23 from Dryden. Randy Russell. So third and 3. See what Portage is going to decide to do on this one. With just under 10 minutes left in the game, it appears that, yeah, they're going to go for it. Tyler Morris receives the ball. And Gage Foster takes it to his left side and is pursued quite well on the ball. It's got no room and will be tackled behind the original line of scrimmage at about the 40-yard line.
Wow, once again, Dryden, that defense is just flying around, making plays after plays.
So loss of 4 on the play. Turnover on downs for Dryden will pick up the ball from the 41-yard line of Portage and Prairie. Up 14-0 with 9:32 left in the fourth quarter. Hicks lines up under center, takes the ball back and will take it to the left on his own, but is met on the ball by number 55 from Portage La Prairie for a sack well behind the line. Big loss, Greg.
Avery Spence, what a great play by him. Coming up field, fighting off the defender and wrapping up on Hicks. Great play.
It appears to have lost about 8 yards on the play, so it'll be second and about 18 yards. It has been a good defensive battle since Dryden has scored its second touchdown, Greg.
Yeah, not a lot of offense this second half. Some really good football, but not a lot of scores going on.
Been able to move the ball at times, but both defenses have managed to stop them when it counted. Second and 18, and Hicks will drop back and throw the ball up and get his receiver. Oh, and Bob is knocked out, so for an incomplete pass, attempted to get it to number 80.
Great play here. You're going to see on the replay here the free safety coming up and making a great hit, number 45. Bryce Verwey coming up and making a huge hit on the play, knocking the ball out of the receiver's hands.
Number 80, Donovan Paranto from Dryden. The ball got knocked away from him last minute, so they will punt. And Gage Foster is back to receive this one to the left, and it looks like it's coming his way. Goes over his head and it gets dropped on the ground, but he picks it up. Flag on one side of the play. Tackled almost right away on the play by Dryden. Wait for the call from the referees. Holding.
I just keep waiting for Portage, one of their big playmakers, to make a play here. And Dryden's doing a great job of containing their star players.
So the penalty is holding against Portage, so that will push them back a little bit further. 8 minutes and 12 seconds left in the first quarter, down 14-0. Have been able to move the ball, but not been able to finish when they need to. Played a good game so far.
Taking a look at the Portage sideline there, you can see the kids and coaches who work hard throughout the football year.
So Portage will start. Play is blown dead by the referees. He goes over to talk to Tyler Morris. So the referee's moving the ball to the other side of the hash marks, or away from the middle anyway. Why might they do that, Greg?
Well, they're in the pistol formation, so they got two backs in behind their quarterback, and obviously the goalpost was standing in impeding the progress of the running backs there. So I think the smart thing for the referee to do is just whistle it dead and move the ball to the hash.
And he did put a few seconds back on the clock for them too, so Tyler Morris will be standing actually in his end zone. Hand the ball off to number 35, his running back, Brandon Friesen, who will get up to about the 6 or 7 yard line.
Again, another high snap on that, Brian.
Yeah.
Those high snaps can sometimes slow the play down or
ruin the timing of the play for sure if he has to bring it down to get it in position. So he did manage to get it up to about the 8 yard line, so 2nd and 5. This time it's Gage Foster who takes the ball and finds some room up the middle and will make something happen and get himself about 10, 15 yards on the play to definitely get a first down. Good run on the inside from Gage Foster, Greg.
Great tackle by Darian Cameron on that too as well. Gage is sure a shifty runner. You never know which way he's going to turn or twist. Once again, it's a good effort by Dryden defense. Portage has called a timeout here.
Definitely has some great lateral movement that helped to make something happen there. Busted off a couple of tackles.
Pretty fast guy. Definitely want to put the ball in his hands if you want a big play. Well, once again, Brian, it's been a great evening of football. We've had, earlier this evening, we had the Winnipeg High School Football League Bowl game, which had Kildonan East Reavers versus St. John's Tigers. Kildonan pulled off the win at 35-32. And we have a really, not a high-scoring game, more of a defensive gem here, but great football going on between Portage, Trojans, and Dryden Eagles.
What I'm seeing is that they've been able to move the ball at times, but just when they need to get it into scoring position, the defense has really come up strong and prevent anything, the score from changing at all. Another high snap, but brought down in place for, and look at number 35 again, Brendan Friesen. Good job to bring that down.
Again, I'm really impressed with Tyler Morris for Portage. Great 10 quarterback. He's obviously those snaps are not perfect, and he's able to bring that snap down, make the read, and do a great job with running this offense. A little bit of a timeout again. I believe Portage running back has a scrape on his arm, so they're going to have to send him off and get it all bandaged up and stuff like that. Tomorrow we have the CTV Bowl at 5 p.m. here at the Investors Group Field, pitting Kelvin Clippers versus Steinbach Sabres. And at 7:30, the WHSFL Championship game in the Anavitz Bowl pits St. Paul's Crusaders versus Vincent Massey Trojans. Again, Vincent Massey's the defending champions, and look for a great rematch. And I'm sure St. Paul's looking for a little bit of revenge for the loss last year.
And I looked at their records, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but St. Paul's was perfect this year. And the only team that Vincent Massey lost to
was St. Paul.
Was St. Paul. So we should have a good game.
And that was week one.
Yes.
Yeah, and it was by 1 or 2 points.
I think it was 1 point.
Yeah. So it's going to be a great game, great matchup. Both teams are well coached. Coaches have been to the Anavitz Bowl for a number of years here. Stacy Daynard over at St. Paul's, he knows how to coach and get his team into the final. And Kelsey McKay over at Vincent Massey, formerly at Churchill, he's obviously brought a winning tradition and winning program into a new, fairly new program over at Vincent Massey. They've been around for about six, 7 years now. So he's done a fantastic job building that program. They have a a JV program or JV team over there that feeds right into their varsity program. So kudos to those teams. We're looking forward to a great game tomorrow.
So second and four, Portage will take the next play. And Morse takes it and looks up middle, and up the middle gets, looks like Brandon Friesen, who came back on the play after being patched up, gets the first down for Portage. Up to the 34-yard line.
Nice little run. He ran with a lot of authority on that play.
Waited for his blocking to help him out a bit too, to make up a little bit more room. So first and 10 from the 34-yard line. Morse hands off again to Friesen, who gets contained almost right away. Might get back to the line of scrimmage. Maybe a little bit more. Not quite a yard. So we're looking at second and 9. A little bit of a sense of urgency coming from Portage. I see they're getting up over the ball quicker with just 5.5 minutes left in the game. Down 14 to nothing. They do need to move the ball down the field. So another high snap for Moore, but it holds it in. The ball thrown out to the flat to the left side, and nobody there to receive it. So with 3rd and 9, down 14 to nothing with 5:18 left in the game, I'm going to assume that they're going to go for it.
Hard to do that on your own 35, so I guess they're going to send in the punt team.
Yeah, and that's what it appears like. I was wrong on that one.
Pin their hopes on the defense to shut down Dryden and get the ball back for their offense.
So Gage Foster, who has had a big impact on this game, will continue to punt.
Can we think maybe a fake here? What do you think?
Well, at this point in time, it would not hurt.
You got Gage back there. He's pretty quick, so.
Leave it on the field. No, nope. He's got it away. Not one of his better kicks tonight, though. So it'll come out of bounds at about the, they're giving him the 47-yard line. So Dryden will take over the ball, the 47-yard, their own 47-yard line, with just under 2 seconds, under 5 minutes left in the game. Up 14 to nothing. Portage needing a big defensive stand here to try and keep themselves into the game. I would venture that if Dryden scores right here, it'd be very difficult for Portage.
Yeah, Portage wants to keep this a two-score game. If Dryden's able to score and make it a three-score game, then yeah, it's a little bit tougher for them to come back.
Safety blitz there, and up into the middle of the play is number 33 from Dryden, Liam Wolstad. Got about 8 yards. It was a flag on the play, however.
Thrown by the line judge close to us here.
There's no infraction. Number 57 did report in.
Picking up the flag on the play, there's no infraction. So second and 1, that was a 9-yard run on the play for Rolstad. So Hicks will go under center, hand the ball off, and pushing forward and getting the first down is again 33, Wolstad.
Again, he's like a little ball of hate, hey? He just runs hard and runs upfield. He's got great power, great strength, great balance.
Definitely no quitting that young man. So first and 10 from the 51-yard line. Hicks takes the ball and goes out to his left side, but is contained and might get a yard or two past that. Tackled on the play. But so maybe a yard on the play. So second and 9 for the 50-yard line, just inside the 50-yard line.
Well, if I'm Portage with 3:30 left in the game, I'm depending on my defense here to make the huge play. They need to have a takeaway here for sure.
It is a big time for a big stop for Portage, so we'll see what happens. Hicks drops back to pass, and there's a flag on the play. I would venture this is going to be a holding call. And wide open is number, and tackled it at about the 4-yard line. But there is a flag on the play.
57.
Pass is complete there to Gunnar Anderson.
Logan Moran. Nice little stiff arm there too. Huge play if this stands.
There's no infraction on the play. 57 was an added run and he did report in.
So 57 had reported in as an eligible receiver. Obviously not a number 57. The number 57 is not usually an eligible number for going out for catching passes. So he would have reported into the referee as an eligible receiver. Referee Ken Lazarick, I believe that's referee Ken Lazarick, who's been around Winnipeg High School Football League, the CFL, done Grey Cup games for a number of years. Said that there's picked up the flag and said there's no flag on the infraction on the play.
So in the last play, Jared Hicks keeps the ball and gets himself down to about the 2 yard line, maybe even the one. Timeout on the play, maybe not. Second and goal from the 1 yard line for Dryden.
I expect Dryden to slow down here a little bit and take a little bit more time off the clock. If they're able to score here, I think the lights are going to turn off soon.
It will be very difficult for Portage to catch up on a 21-0 lead.
Turn out the lights. Party's over.
Time back in. Again, Hicks lines up under center. Only one wide receiver. And he will step back and give it to number 35.
Wolstead.
Number 33, Wolstead gets a touchdown for Dryden to put them up 20-0 with the point after still to come. Going to be very tough for Portage now, Greg.
Again, that little ball hit, running hard, pushing the pile forward, getting into the end zone. Nothing was going to stop him on that play.
And I will tell you that, I'm going to say this now, that 20-0 is not indicative of how well Portage has played. They've played well today, just not been able to score when they've got themselves down into scoring position.
You know, Brian, they often say defense wins championships, and I'd say that for sure Dryden's defense was able to contain Portage today.
Yeah, I would have to agree with you on that one.
Great coaching job, great job by the players on the Dryden defense.
So with 2 minutes and 26 seconds left, Dryden gets ready to kick off the ball back to Portage, and we're going to have to see the ball move pretty deeply by Portage right off the bat to make anything happen at all with this late into the game for sure.
Well, it's a little tough for Portage too, because they have I think he's played great. It's Tyler Morris, the great 10 quarterback. I think he's had a great game. But it's hard to put a great 10 quarterback out on the field and expect miracles with 2:26 left in the game.
Bit of a squib hit picked up on the play by number 45 from Portage, who will take the ball down at about the 42-yard line. He tackled on the play.
Bryce Verway on the kickoff return. And you know what's nice? You can see in the picture right now that a lot of fans came to Winnipeg from Dryden, and you can see some of the signage along the far side there, along the sideline. Nice to see.
So first and 10 from their own 43-yard line. Portage needing to move the ball to make something happen. Get another high snap, but Gage Foster in reverse comes back, and the ball comes to the right side. Needs to beat one man or a couple of men to get something to happen. Will get enough for a first down. About a 12, 13-yard gain, 14-yard gain on the play.
Thomas Moline on the tackle, and injured Dryden player down on his knee right now. So we'll get a timeout now.
So good play to make something happen right off the bat.
Well, it moves the chains, get them going. Try to get something going out of this offense and try to get a score on the board. You gotta approach this as you gotta get on the board real quick right now, and hopefully you can get the ball back on a short kick.
A couple of short kicks. So we have an injury on the play. Dryden player coming off.
He's jogging off. He seems to be okay.
Maybe just winded on the play. Looks like number 23 from Dryden. Randy Russell. We've said his name a couple times today.
Grade 12 captain.
So Tyler Morris takes the ball. Looks to pass downfield. Does have a player open. Gage Foster catches the ball for a gain of about 6-7 yards. Portage will need to get up and over the ball pretty quickly if they want to try to continue to move that ball down the field. Referee blows the ball in. We are about a minute, 45 seconds left in the fourth quarter. Morris takes the ball, second and four. Hands the ball off to his running back, Brandon Friesen, who will get tackled behind the line of scrimmage and lose 2 or 3 yards. Not the play that they wanted to happen at this point in the game.
Again, great job by the Dryden defense to hustle to the ball.
Great contain. Brandon was not able to get to any space and make something happen. So right now it all lays on the line on this play for Portage. Morris continues in quarterback, snaps back and hands off to number 88, but he will be tackled well short of the first down at about the 50-yard line. Number 88, Tyler Fedek.
Great tackle by Gus Barroso. Sorry, Brasso. Textbook tackle, really. Nice and low, wrapped up around the legs. Stopped the player right in his tracks.
So with a minute and 11 seconds left in the game, Dryden will take over on downs at their own 47-yard line. What do you think we can expect to see from Dryden for the rest of this game now?
Well, they're just going to be conservative and kill the clock here.
Portage does have one timeout.
Probably see a lot of number 33, the little ball of hate.
And he will take it right up the middle. Number 33, as you called it, Rolstead, will get about 8-9 yards. Number 55 from the Portage, real slow getting up, but he's back in the game. He's not going to finish like that. So that was a first down from the Portage 51-yard line. I don't think we'll see Hicks pass the ball at any point in time. I would assume it's going to stay on the ground. 45 seconds left in the game.
Yeah, they're in the victory formation, so they're going to wind the clock down as much as they can, take a knee. And I know Portage has one timeout left, but I don't know if they'll use it.
Again, as I said a little while ago, Greg, that although we're finishing with a score right now at 21-0, and I'm assuming that's how we're going to be done, not indicative of the way Portage has played today. You know, they were able to move the ball at times, but just not able to get in the end zone when they had those opportunities.
Yeah, the big difference is Dryden's had 2 or 3 really long plays, huge long plays, putting them in a great position to score.
And made use of their opportunities when they did get in the scoring zone.
That's right. So down on the field, I can see Commissioner Rick Hinkwich. He's getting ready to present the Canons Bowl trophy. And, really congratulations for both teams for a great year, for making it all the way up to the Canons Bowl. Again, Portage has nothing to hang their head about. And congratulations to Dryden for a huge win.
So on that note, we finish. Congratulations to the Dryden Eagles, who have won the Canadian Bowl for 2016 at the Investors Group Field in the Winnipeg High School Football League. Great game today. I completely concur with Greg. Both teams played very well. The score is not indicative of how well Portage played. They did play well. Unfortunately, weren't able to get into the end zone. But did deserve to be in this game today. And that would make Dryden, as I thought about this, that's a perfect season for Dryden. It's a really nice way to finish.
Great job by Dryden, their coaches. Obviously, their parents for traveling all the way out to Winnipeg to take in the championship game here. For a lot of these kids, it's their last game. high school football league game, and you know, it's always great to go out on top. And again, for Portage, those kids who they have a lot of really good players. They have a grade 10 quarterback who showed a lot of poise, a lot of promise. You know, hopefully Portage can, with a team like that, you don't rebuild, you just reload, and hopefully they can make it back to the championship game again.
I do have the benefit of a list right now with the grades for each team, and Portage has a number of grade 11s on the team, so they got a fairly decent number of returning players, including Tyler Morris, who actually is only in grade 10. And Connor Green, their kicker, who was kicking really well today, who's only in grade 11. Unfortunately, they'll lose Gage Foster, who's in grade 12.
Tyler Fedak in grade 11 will be back next year, and you know, look for big things from him. I was very impressed with his overall speed and agility and determination to catch the ball. And obviously, Portage has a lot to be proud of. And like I said before, look for them to reappear in the Canadiens Bowl again next year.
The Jared Hicks from Dryden is only in grade 11, so he should be back next year. Their running back, Adrian Bebo, who we did see a few times, is only in grade 10. So, you know, a core to build on even from Dryden. So we should see some good games even with these teams next year.
Fortunately for Dryden, they have a long bus ride, but it's going to be a good bus ride.
So we're looking forward to tomorrow. As you said, we've got two more games to finish off the Winnipeg High School football bowls. At 5 o'clock, we have the Kildonan East. Nope, sorry, I'm looking at the wrong list. We have the CTV Bowl, the Calvin Clippers versus Steinbach Sabres. And then to finish, the Anavets Bowl, St. Paul's Crusaders versus the Vincent Massey Trojans, rematch of last year, which both games should prove to be very exciting and entertaining games. We encourage you to join us again tomorrow night from LRSTV as we continue to stream the Winnipeg High School football game. So go to LRSD.TV and find the links for the games that will take place tomorrow night. We're going to stick around, I believe, for the presentation of the trophies. So as we finish, we're hoping that we're going to be able to speak to the coach of the winning team. We do have a reporter down on the field right now. We're waiting for the presentation of the trophy.
So just announced that Jared Hicks from Dryden was the player of the game.
Well deserving.
Jared Hicks over with Commissioner Rick Henkwich receiving his award. And shortly thereafter, they'll be providing the championship banners and the Canadiens Bowl championship.
Captains of the Portage Collegiate Trojans.
Gentlemen, congratulations on your accomplishment of getting to this game today. I know that losing is a tough thing, but you also need to remember that there's 24 teams that have traded places with you in a heartbeat. They would love to be here, and you've got this to last your lifetime. So Portage, your finalist banner for the Canadiens Bowl, and congratulations on a great season and the job well done.
And now the presentation of the Canadiens Bowl champions for 2016, the Dryden Eagles. Like the captains to please step forward and accept the banner, trophy, and medals from Commissioner Rick Hankowich.
Gentlemen, congratulations. An undefeated season, testament to you guys, to your coaching staff, to the dedication, hard work you put in. So congratulations. We start this off with the banner, first of all. All right, all you guys hold that, get your pictures with that, then we'll take care of the real business. Now, the Canadiens Trophy, gentlemen. Congratulations to the Dryden Eagles.
Okay. Well, again, we are looking forward to tomorrow night when we get to finish with two pretty exciting games. And we're just waiting to finish for our interviewers down on the field to meet with the coach of the Dryden Eagles and get his perspective on how the game went today. I've got to tell you, Greg, been two great football games for us to cover today. And kudos to both teams and both coaches in prepping these teams to play as well as they did.
Yeah, I mean, congratulations to both teams. Obviously, Dryden capping off an undefeated season is a great way to finish the year, and especially for the grade 12 kids who, been with the team for a long time to end their high school football career with a huge win. It's great to see, again, the Winnipeg High School Football League extending all the way out to Dryden, Fort Francis, Kenora, all the way to Brandon. It's a great community of football teams, and, great on Rick Hankowich and everyone in the Winnipeg High School Football League for building such a thriving, great opportunity league for young men and women to play in.
And having an opportunity today to listen to Coach Grinnell and Coach Wilson coming in and watch what he's seeing here. I'm thinking he's got quite a few possibilities in terms of recruitment down the road. Some of the talent I've been able to see today, some of these players that I've seen for the first time, is they're pretty exciting.
Yeah, and I mean, these players are it's football's become a full-time sport. Most teams, they'll take a week or two off after the last game.
So we're headed down to the field right now as we're going to interview the head coach of the Dryden Eagles after his win at the Canadiens Bowl. So we'll take it down to the field.
I'm here with the coach of the Dryden Eagles who just won their game. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about how you thought your team played today.
They dug deep. It was a tough battle. Portage played very hard, as we thought they would. And we never quite broke. We stayed strong throughout and didn't let any small errors magnify themselves.
So does your team have anything to do after this?
Unfortunately, it's riding a bus home, getting home at 3 o'clock in the morning, but nothing big planned, no. I'm sure they'll do something this weekend, though.
Absolutely. All right, well, thank you for your time. And that's it for today. Thank you for tuning into LRSD TV.